All right. Hello, here we have a Motorola SK77 from around about 62, 63. Really nice unit, very, very popular. In need of a complete service. The 77 was a little slimmer than the 32s and the 52s, SK52 32s, by about 2 inches. The 52, funnily enough, is actually 52 inches wide. This one's about 2.5 inches shorter. It's had, the record player's had a little bit of abuse. Linkage is not working. Also, big telltale signs, when you lift it up, you can actually take it out because the transport clips have been taken off. So that means another expert has been in there. It also didn't want to power up originally at all. And already took the record holder out. I just want to look at this tuner section here, preamp tuner section. It didn't want to power up at all. And eventually I got it to power up by rehooking the phono input back up. So it did power up, but no audio whatsoever. So there's something definitely going in here. I actually put a signal into the amplifier section itself when I did get it powered up. We do have audios. That's a really, really good sign. But there's something going on with the preamp tuner section. But that's okay, because we're going to fix it. Stay tuned. Okay, so we're in the back of the SK77. As you can see, it's a 3-channel unit. Look at that beautiful, I think it's 14-inch woofer. I think they used to be 15s, but they went a little bit smaller, I think. Great amplifier, 6 V6 GTA output tubes. This thing puts out a nice punch, it really does. The only caveat is that you can't control the third channel. So you do get a little bit of excessive bass. I've actually seen these hooked up with their own rheostat potentiometer control to actually turn the bass down, because it does overpower sometimes. On the previous models, you could actually turn it off with a switch that was up inside the record player compartment. Anyway, still a great sounding unit. This is the MPX. That was the decoding stereo back in the day. I think they came standard on the 77s, but the early ones, it was an optional extra. Here's the very lot smaller Vibrasonic unit. They were used to be bigger and hang down the side here. So that's a little Vibrasonic, and there's your tuner preamp section. A lot of wires, awful lot of wires and connections. So make notes. Make little marks, take photographs, plenty of photographs. And I just get like a Sharpie and I put a little line here and a line there and all that good stuff. Just so you know where it's all gonna go back together and there's no headaches. So lots of photos, a little bit of marking, and you'll be good. Now this guy is held in by, I think, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's one in the back here, 5/16 mounting nuts. And just get yourself one of these and so yeah, get those out, undo your plugs, make notes, make photos, and we'll get it on the bench. Okay, we've got the amp out and it's on the bench. Took lots of photos, did some markings, and now we're gonna, as you can see right there, marking stuff right there, starting to take stuff out. The tuner, from what I can tell you, see this right there? There's two, one here, one on the other side, and it's just held in by washers and wing nuts. But anyway, start to disconnect, label, photograph. Can't stress that enough. More to come. Okay, this thing's quite the challenge because all the connections for the MPX, phono, amplifier, they're all tucked up in there. So I think you're gonna drag all these cables out when you lift this thing out. Also, this unit here is gonna have to come off because the antenna, external antenna connection is also connected, as well as the tape input, which is interesting. It's mono or one, I don't know how you describe it. Usually there's two left and right. So that's a new thing I've not seen before on a Motorola. But yeah, quite the challenge to get this thing out. Okay, we got everything out on the bench. This thing's upside down, so I could show you that those are the connections that you can't see that are tucked up underneath there, which is very strange. And these are all the wires I had to pull out with it as you lift the tuner out. Now, I put a rubber band around and actually had someone help me thread these as I lifted this thing out so everything wouldn't get caught up. But anyway, it's all there apart from the record changer, but we got to figure out what's going on with this guy. Okay, first things first, let's take this guy off. This is the AM antenna board, as you can see right there. So we're gonna take that off so we can actually start getting at the more interesting stuff. This is quite an interesting design and not one I'm a big fan of. This is my first SK77. I've done a bunch of 52s and 32s, but first SK77, and what we're gonna have to do is to get to the controls, which are buried in here, we're gonna have to take this whole section off, which I'm guessing is the preamp section because it's got tubes in it, and there'll be capacitors in there. So we've gotta pull all these knobs and then take this section off. So then we can get to the tuner section where the controls are, and that's hopefully where our problem is of not getting any audio or powering up from those switches, if you remember. Okay, we've got those separated, took the plate off, and having a look inside here for the underneath of the tuner section. These are those controls. That's the on and off. They are a little gummed up. It might be just a case of giving them a clean, but the, if I get the actual on-off power tumbler is down in there. That could be also stuck closed. So we'll check into that. Otherwise it looks pretty clean. I mean, there's nothing burned out, just discoloration. But this is like old glue stuff, but not bad. The preamp section we've got there. Do take the tubes out. I just left them so I could show you because that's how pins get broken. And to get this off, you gotta take the faceplate off, which is held on by 1, 2, 3 large nuts. Don't use a set of pliers. You'll slip and scratch this beautiful plate. 3/4 socket, straight on, hand tight, undo. All right. Okay, so we got the cover off. And this is all the control section right here. And the first thing I saw was this. That is not factory. We'll get the schematic out and see what's going on there. But yeah, previous experts being in here, which always scares me. Be afraid, be very afraid. But this orange cable, this from this capacitor goes over to this 12AX72, so let's see what that one does. And that is Vibrasonic preamp. They got a tone amp and the first AF amp for everything else, but somebody's been in messing with the Vibrasonic. But like I said, we'll get the schematic out, see what's going on with that guy. We are gonna clean all the pots with contact cleaner. And if you have a stubborn one, I do use deoxit. There's a whole debate about using deoxit on carbon pots, which I do understand. But sometimes when they're really stubborn, I use this stuff and then clean it out with this stuff. But 9 times out of 10, this stuff does it. All right, and also all these contacts.
Okay.
Okay, we got lucky. I have to clean the contacts and the
power control, power switch, a contact cleaner in there, and I use Deoxit on those contacts, sliding contacts, because they're not pots. We were able to power it up by its own switch. On, and if we go over here, you can see tubes lighting up. So this is a good thing. It's never usually that bloody easy, but so yeah, just a lot of dirt and grime and muck. So we're gonna get busy with recapping now. This faceplate will come off, so we can get behind here and clean this lovely dial face and everything. It looks pretty damn simple. There's kind of one and some, and then some other one, two there, and two on the other side. So that looks simple to get off. But yeah, cleaning, recapping, more to come. Okay, so before you can get the faceplate off, you see I've took the knobs off right there. You're gonna have to take this guy out. This is the, I think it's an EM84 Magic Eye tuning indicator green bulb thing. And it's mounted to the faceplate, so you can't take it up, faceplate off, because it's connected through. So you get these two guys out, one, two. You have to use a small quarter inch wrench. So this socket and bulb tube stays with the tuner section, so you can get that off to clean it. Everything else looks really good. Did a lot of inspecting, checking, check some resistors out, but everything looks really, really nice. But remember, we talked about this guy, this stain right here before, and how we deoxit, we cleaned these contacts for the on-off switches. Well, kind of occurred to me, this is the plate, the protection plate that goes on there. Well, we're about to clean it up and put it back on, and I just thought, oh, that's what happened. Basically, somebody spilt Coca-Cola, coffee, something through there. It dripped all the way through here, corroded that up, and ended up on the bottom right there. So that's what happened. Corrosion, rust, whatever it was, a little bit of Coke, coffee, and that's why we don't drink our beverages over our units. All right. Okay, so if you remember, when we opened up this preamp section, we found this cap that looked a bit not factory installation, but in fact it was. I checked the schematic, all was good. It was a 10 UF 400 volt, and this thing was attached to it, this 4.7k resistor, and yeah, the workmanship's just not brilliant, so that's why it looked like it was done by a previous expert. But I guess they put tape on because of the tightness of the space in there was so tight. They used tape and didn't have shrink tubing or stuff like that, I guess. So anyway, look at the size of the modern replacement compared to that. So it fits in there nicely. New resistor. Also, I put a zip tie here because when this gets pulled, which it shouldn't, but it could get pulled, it would pull this against here and would have all kinds of sparks. And I'll probably drop a little bit of hot glue right down on that. But it's pretty damn secure. Anyway, bit of cleaning and we'll get it fired up soon. Hey. So with the tuner section pretty much done, we're gonna get started on the amp. This is an HS1048B amplifier. It is a very, very nice, good, powerful unit for its day. And we're going to pause these tubes. We're going to clean everything, including the sockets, and then we're going to do the recap on this. We've got some AF amp tubes here, 12XX7, and then we've got the output tubes, the 6V6 GTAs, great tubes. We're going to clean these sockets, as you can see here, different size here. A larger and the smaller regular socket. And what you want to do is, once you've given everything a good clean, deoxit, whatever, is I use these diamond files and to clean these guys out, because they've got a lot of corrosion, a lot of dirt over the years, and get the right size one, which that is, isn't it? This guy right here. And you basically, these are diamond files, they're diamond encrusted, You basically good. These are good clean out. Not too much, just enough to make the contacts good so your tubes are going to work well. And there's different sizes. Obviously, you'll need a different size for this guy right here. Anyway, diamond round files, good thing to have in your kit. Also, I was starting to look at these tubes a little bit, and you can see this nice shiny stuff on top is called, it's called the getter, the flashed getter. And from what I can gather, this coating helps disperse bad gases within the vacuum itself. Don't quote me on that, Google it, but this is a flashed mirror getter on the inside. There's also other stuff in there. But as you can see on this one, see, this has got a nice mirror-like finish. This one doesn't. And when you start seeing them like this, the getter's going, the flashed getter, it means the tube is not going to perform as well, because it's all about helping that vacuum stay a vacuum. So when you see start seeing the inside there, definitely test this thing and test it just so you can see that it's not going to work, perform well. And maybe we'll do that. Maybe I'll get the my tube tester after this, and we'll compare and see what numbers this thing's giving out, just to show that. All right, bit of cleaning, and then we're going to get to that guy. Okay, so now we get to the fun stuff. We're going to chop this guy off and replace this can cap here, multi-can cap. Now, I've talked about this in detail on the Zenith restoration video, so I'm not going to go into too much detail, as you can always refer to that. But right now, we're going to use this guy and get it there to cut nice and level off. Voila. All right, as you can see, we've got 40-40-40 and a 200. All the 40s are 400 volts, and the 200s are 50 volt. See all that stuff right there? That soft goo? That means it was leaking. It's also here. The goo was leaking, and that means your capacitor will not be performing as it should. So that's why we chop these babies off. A lot of time people go, oh, it looks great. No, it's 60 years old. It ain't gonna be great, kind of like me. All right, okay, so we chopped that off and we did some markings right here for the corresponding, I'll lift it up so you can see, for the corresponding symbols that are on this guy. As you can see, I'll try to catch it in the right light. Each cap has its own symbol, half moon, square, triangle, and the blank. That was the 200, nothing there, so that's on the blank side. On the other side, there'll be the same symbols so that you can transfer your markings to there so you know which is which. Obviously, that blank one is the 200. We're gonna do something a little different with the 200. I use a 1/16 drill bit. I usually drill on the insides because the outsides is tough to get, wrap it around, but check your spacing on the other side, whether you want to do it on the inside or the outside. Because this is a tight fit, as you can see, three of those on there, what we're going to do is a little different with the, with the 200, we're going to do a little bit different on the other side. Now, also you notice that they're all 200s and 40-40-40 and 200. Well, those values aren't as common as they are now. So we're going to do a 220. Obviously, the voltage will always be at the correct voltage or better. But a little bit more capacitance doesn't really matter on the power side. These are all 47s. It calls for 40. But a little bit more capacitance on the power side of things is not going to hurt. It'll actually do a little better. It'll do a bit more cleaning, if you know what I mean. So, and also, if you watch the other video, the Zenith, we want to make sure the polarity is right. Get yourself one of these for whatever project you're doing, the Photo Fact. And as you can see, on this one, we are going to be going, if I can get it up there, there's the power side of those cans. You'll see it's negative to ground. I don't know if you remember, watch the Zenith one, solid state. Zeniths were positive to ground. Can cause confusion, so always look at the schematic. But here we are negative to ground. So basically, it'll all be all like this. Look, see, there. We'll show you that soon. All right, flip this baby over. I'll show what we're gonna do with the 200. So we've got, right here, we've got triangle. What is that? That's the blank one. And then we've got square and half moon. So this is blank. So that's the 200. And because there's not much room on top, what I'm gonna do is, I'm literally gonna put this one right there. There's a nice grounded prong mount there. So we're gonna put this, as it's gonna sit in there very, very nicely, as you can see. I'll show you the finish. And that'll give us a bit more room on top to get those big fat boys on there, if you know what I'm saying. All right, so we got our new fat boys in there, as you can see. Bit of shrink tube in, some hot glue, and then if we turn it over, you can see what I did with that 220 for the 200. Just tucked it in there nicely. Everything's all soldered up. And we're good to go. I thought we'd do a little bit of tube testing. This is my Precision 600. I think it's a 612, but 600 series. It's a great tube tester that I've used. Right now we have one of the tubes in, which actually has a bit of slight getter issue on the side right there. But we've got everything set up to do the test. And we'll see what kind of readout he's giving us. All right, so that's 82 on this scale. It'll be different. The different scales, Hickox, have their own. But on this scale, 82. And normally, all the my tubes are in the 80 to 90 range. If you get over 90, it's usually a brand new tube. But this NOS stuff is usually between 80 and 90, depending on the type of tube. So let's swap that out. That's a good tube, even though the getter is slightly starting to go. And here's our one with the getter's completely gone. We'll put that in. We'll turn it on, let it heat up a little bit. So I've had it on before, so it should be getting there. But anyway, we'll get our test reading and we'll see how it compares. Oh, something's wrong there. And it's still heating up. There you go. 3, 4, 5 on the dial. Yep. And there you can see we're at, what is that? 876. So definitely not as good as the other tube. Probably get some life out of it. But don't forget, this is a tester. It's not really testing under extreme conditions when you've got that thing cranked up to number 11 on the dial. But anyway, good to know, 76 compared to the other one was 82. And it's got a bit of life in it. I'll probably put it in the bass channel and let the customer know if he wants to replace it or not. Okay, so we have got stuff on the bench to do some bench testing. Things seem to be working nicely. We've yet to recap that, but this is all open just so for testing that I can get at stuff if anything goes untoward. Let's have a listen. So yeah, that's FM. Seems to be working nicely. We've got to get into this guy, the MPX unit. The stereo indicator light's not working. It's a neon bulb. I don't think it's the bulb. But I'm only getting like 40 to 50 volts there. I think it needs at least 65 to even start flickering. But I'll double check on that. But this is powered up right now, so be careful. But yeah. See that there on the big cap? That's bursting. So that's not good. Anyway, we'll dig into that. But so far, so good.
150 colleges and universities, and only the seventh student in UNLV's history.
Okay, after recapping the MPX unit and changing out a resistor on that stereo indicator circuit, we got the bulb to go start flashing. There we go. It's weird that it only seems to work on the Spanish speaking stations though. Okay, so before we put everything back in, it's usually a good idea to get the cabinet blown out with a compressor, compressor and gun, and get all the 60 years of accumulated dust and dirt out of there before you do a little bit of cleaning as well, especially on the grill covers. There's a lot of dust in there. Yeah. Okay, we got it back in. We did some blowing out. You can see there's still a lot of dirt on there that's kind of baked on. We'll clean that off. But I just want to mention that now that you've got everything out, you're going to do some cleaning, is a good time to replace those crossover caps right there. I'm not sure what that is. Can I read it? It's a 5 MFD, non-polarized. Electrolytic but non-polarized. You can get other ones, I think they're called polys. They get to be very big, but to get it non-polarized is good. There's a vibrosonic unit again, and that one is tucked up in there underneath the record player section. So now's a good time to replace those. Also, do you remember we talked about how somebody spilt their beverage down on this guy and the controls weren't working, they were gummed up, so there was getting no power to turn it on. Well, before I started cleaning, I started to look there, and yeah, that's a nice spill mark. That was somebody's Coca-Cola beer beverage of choice. As you can see, that's why we don't drink over our units. Also, talking about vibrosonic, I left it in there. Vibrosonic goes basically to these tweeters right here. I didn't want to take everything out to test it. On the bench, I think I'm going to test it inside. And remember this 6V6 GTA that was had a discolored getter. The getter was, the flash getter was all going on it. Well, I decided to put that in the vibrosonic section and see if it still works nicely. And the reason I let the customer know that all the tubes tested pretty damn good except this one. And it's up to them if they really want to replace them, because, you know, with the tube crisis going on in Europe and what have you, all tube prices have skyrocketed through the roof. These guys go anywhere between 25 and 50 bucks each. So there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You do the math. Anyway, bit of cleaning and we'll get it in there. More testing. Oh, while we're talking about what to do before putting stuff back in, now's a real good time to cinch up the all the speaker mount screws. All those nuts get loose. They all need, as you can see, that's quite a few turns. And that'll just help a little bit of less speaker vibration. You do them all. This is an 11/32 XL nut driver. These things are a lifesaver. Here's the set. If you're gonna do this, get one in your kit. They're great. Hey, here's a top tip for you. So when you pull those crossover caps, you have the leads attached. What I do is I snip off the ends. Was a screwdriver. I snip off the ends, then solder them to the new cap. That's a 4.7.
that was a five, solder the ends, and then you're able to just slip that guy back on and plug it in with the original lead.
This is a Voice of Music made turntable licensed to Motorola. There are hundreds of thousands of them in different forms. It's a very, very reliable turntable. It's a good turntable. There's a lot of people have done amazing videos on how to restore these. I'm really not gonna go mental into detail because it's been done before, probably way better by other people than me. But I'll go through some of the basics. Okay, so while I was actually thinking and talking to you about this and how I was going to explain everything and not make it into a rebuild video of the turntable, because that's what it's going to turn into, and it's really about the Motorola that I'm doing, I just wanted to kind of interject with a really great way of doing this. First of all, get yourself one of these. It's the Photo Fact for VM record changer. Not necessarily this one, but they're very, very similar in the build. There's just only some modifications as they got younger and younger. And also, there's a gentleman on Antique Radios called Ed Morris who did a superb, in-depth rebuild of a VM changer. It was a Cobra-matic, but the guts are basically the same. This is the guy I learned from. I referred to his page on antiqueradios.com. I will put up the link because he explains everything with pictures, diagrams, notations, what everything's called, right, what everything's done. And it's just going to be way better if you refer to that than me trying to turn this thing into a rebuild video of this turntable. Okay, so I'm basically just going to start going, showing little tricks that I do to service these. But you could watch this, have his page open, and you would really, really learn way better than me not doing it justice. Because it's about a Motorola and not really a rebuild video of this turntable. Let's get started. Now, if you remember when we first looked at this, this was all loose. Well, it was just simply the grub screw that attaches it to the up and down rod. So tighten that up. This was also loose. Screw fell out, so we did that. Also, a spring needs to be reattached, so it springs back. But yeah, it's a bit grubby. Usually there's a little rubber O-ring around here, a white O-ring to keep the platter down. It's already been taken off. Another telltale sign that a previous expert has been in here. Anyway, this just pops off once you've got that ring off. And the first thing I saw was this. This is a plastic idler wheel. And they are absolute crap. Cheap rubbish. This one is already split down here. The original one's made of metal. I was going to try and grab one. I should have one right here. But there's the, it's made of, I think it's brass or bronze. But that's a real one. And that isn't. So that's the first mistake. These are absolute rubbish. But I have plenty of these in parts in stock, so we'll put a new refurbished idler wheel on it. So yeah, first thing to do is to pop out the main drive gear retainer. I put all my bits in here, this yellow tray here, so everything's not rolling around and hard to see on wood and what have you, but get yourself some kind of tray. It doesn't have to be this kind of yellow one from Harbor Freight. It could be anything, any food tray that you had to take away, that kind of stuff. So once we've done that, we'll secure the arm. We're gonna flip this baby over. Oh,
That's what I use. This is a shelf spacer. You get it from Walmart. Get a set of three, or get them from Amazon. They're basically a shelf rack spacer thing. They work out great. I also store turntables on these as well. So we're gonna flip it over. Try and get everything in the frame. Good. And the first thing we see is the transport mechanism. And we're gonna start taking bits off this because as you can see, all this old grease, I think it was animal-based grease, basically starts to harden and goes to glue. This is actually kind of free, which is kind of nice. Usually they don't even move. So we're gonna start taking bits off, and that's why you want this tray. So first thing we're gonna take off is the spindle plunger thingy. Here's another thing. There's a proper technical term for all this stuff. I don't know what the proper technical term is always, but I definitely know what it does. Anyway, so this is the plunger, which pushes the record off the spindle. This action here moves this, pushes that down, and pushes the record off the spindle. That goes off. This comes out. It's usually very dirty and oily. That goes there. Put that down. By this time, when you flipped it over, also the ball bearing race and washer will have fallen out normally. There's one. The ball bearing will fall out in a minute. There it is. So that is going to be cleaned out and new grease. That's the spindle bearing. That's going to be cleaned out. That goes over here. Then we are going to grab, I'm going to, as you can see, it's oily, dirty, greasy stuff already. Got to clean me hand up. We're going to grab this. This is a quarter. And oh, you know what? I wanted to show you something before we do that. So when I first pulled this out, the transport retaining clips were lying at the bottom of the, the transport retaining clips were lying at the bottom. So that means the previous expert didn't realize how to flip these over and literally pried them off with a screwdriver or pliers. So these need to go back on. They go back on there like, well, I'll show you. They just kind of, let me get it on now and show you exactly how they're supposed to work. Give it a bit of a wiggle. There you go. So that's the way it's supposed to be to pull it out. That's the way it's supposed to be when it's inside the console, so that when you suck this screw down, it brings everything down so it doesn't bounce around on a journey, which this thing previously did, because these guys were off. And I'll show you what happened because of that later. Anyway, so they go like that. This one is missing, but that's okay. We have spares. All right, the transport system right here. This is the main rail. 1, 2, 3 retaining screws. This one is different than the rest, and we'll show you why. This one, see, just fell off, has a washer. God damn. This one has a washer. As you can see, and this one will go right here, because this distance is preset, so this thing slides nice and easy. These guys don't have washers because they are tapped to a certain distance so that this, the end of this screw, sits in this perfectly so this unit can slide with a perfect tolerance so it doesn't bind. And we'll grease all this later. So that comes off. And the other one. So they all go in there. Now, when you lift this guy off, there's a spring right here. That's the locating spring for when this guy pops round after its cycle. Just flip that off. You grab it like this, give it a little wiggle, and you kind of just gotta see right here, and off it comes. And then it's also trapped by this guy, which activates that guy.
I'll get the right terminology down eventually. Anyway, There's the main transport system. As you can see, that's all just hardened, non-slippy slidey grease. And we're gonna clean that, and I'll show you a little trick for that soon. So that's off. Here we have the main drive gear, cog, wheel, whatever you wanna call it. And 9 times out of 10, this won't come up easily because, oh, guess what just happened there? That's the ball bearing that this guy rides along. So we're gonna grab that. Sorry, I should have mentioned that. That little ball bearing right there rides up in here. So this guy, when it pushes up the spindle to release the record, has a nice rotating surface. I've lost a couple of those because I've done that many times. Anyway, so that goes in there. Getting back to, yeah, this is usually old grease and is glued together. What you can do is you can lie up a soldering iron against this and leave it for a good 10, 15 minutes and it'll heat up where you can pull it off. I actually have a little blowtorch and I kind of cover this up with a bit of tin can and give it a little blowtorch heat just on this area because I'm too impatient to wait for it to melt off with a soldering iron. This one is actually not bad at all. And off it comes. And as you can see, all nasty, old, dirty animal product grease that's all gotta be cleaned off. So we'll get to that. So another top tip, get yourself a rubber band and secure this shutdown lever here. It's a shut off lever, which hits this assembly right here, because what will happen is when you got all this off, this will flop down and you'll end up putting this on top of that. That's the wrong way. So for that not to happen, get yourself a rubber band and just secure it. So we're gonna take the retard assembly off. And like I said before, please refer to the Ed Morris tutorial. There goes my rubber band. Please refer to the Ed Morris tutorial because it is absolutely invaluable. And you can refer to the pictures and the diagrams, and it's, you know, just the way to go. That's how I learned. All right, off that goes like this. This is the, this disappears, not sure what year, but this disappears eventually. And it's basically what it does is during the cycle, it shuts off the audio from the tone arm cartridge, so you're not hearing pips and pops as it's going through its cycle change. They did away with it eventually, probably cost saving, but flop that over there. We're gonna clean that with contact cleaner. There goes the rubber band again. we're gonna clean that with contact cleaner. Anyway, so the shut off lever assembly right there goes there. There's a little spring. There he is. Be careful. Remember that spring's got to go back on there. And then we have the 7-inch and 10-inch sensor levers. They're going to come off. There's a spring underneath here. And you can see all that dirty grease has got to come off. So we're going to take that off. And I usually place this together. There you can see the spring stuck to it and all the dirty grease. But don't forget about that spring, so keep that over there. This guy is over here with his spring. Then we're gonna loosen, this guy actually doesn't come out because he's kind of trapped by the tone arm lever right here, part of the lever assembly. That's a retard lever and that's part of the other sensor assembly. Like I said, Ed Morris, it'll explain all this way better than I will. We're just gonna go through some tips that I do when I'm cleaning. So we're gonna undo this guy. And we'll put this screw just here, because that's gonna go back on immediately. This flops off. There is a spring underneath there. Just be careful about it, leave it there, because you wanna clean underneath there in a moment. What I use for a lot of cleaning is this stuff, acetone. It's not chemically brilliant for you, so be careful with it. And a lot of Q-tips.
clean the old grease off. I'll probably fast forward through a lot of this stuff, but I use Q-tips, lots of them, to get the old stuff out. Now, you know, you could disassemble this whole thing and take off the whole carriage, everything. It's very rarely needs to be done like that. And you can also find yourself getting into a lot more trouble when you put it back together. So we're just going to be doing some cleaning. Here's a top tip. So this shift lever right here, cycling shift lever, a lot of times that sticks. It's all gummed up in there with stuff. If it's sticky, you have to take this guy out. There's a little spring underneath. Remember how it goes in. Also, that pin will fall out on the floor and you'll lose it. Do you know how I know that? Yep, exactly. So that needs a good clean. It's actually moving very, very freely, so we're not going to take it out. A lot of the times the tone arm shaft assembly, this is a tone arm shaft assembly, which the spring rises the tone arm up and down. Sometimes there's old grease in there. You have to take this off and the spring and the whole shaft out. Doesn't need it on this one, but Ed Morris will show you how to do it. Okay. So we've cleaned underneath here. I never put grease underneath this. It's such a small movement. You don't want it to get gummed up. Sometimes grease actually gums, even new lithium grease. So that is going to stay there. The spring is nice and clean underneath. We'll give this a little clean. And we're gonna pop that baby right back in. Now, so far, this has actually been pretty damn nice as regards to the gunk and the mess. So far so good. We're now gonna get this guy, clean him off. Now we're gonna do a bit of greasing here. I use white lithium grease, put it there, and a brush. And we're gonna put a bunch of grease in here for the 7-inch sensor lever. I think that's what it's called. You'll see there's a little tiny indent right there. That's where the spring's gotta sit in. So when you offer it up, let's put a bit more in there. There you go. So when you offer it up, let's make sure that that spring is sitting on the indent and then push it down. You've cleaned the screw off, of course. And detach it. And yep, see it's trying to pop out. There we go. Oh, good, nice and moving. All right, then we have the shut off assembly lever. And once again, this one, I never put any grease or anything. It's all clean. I'm sure people put some oil in there, but it's such a nice fine finish. I don't think you actually need anything. And sometimes there's too much grease in these things. All right, don't forget the spring. That little guy's got to go straight in there. And now you can see if this thing has flopped over, you accidentally forget and you put that on top. And then you put it all together and you go, oh shit. to get it, the locator and the spring correctly, as he's trying to do that. As you can see, sometimes a little tricky, and oops. Good, the little locator. Actually, let me show you that little locator right there. That's where the spring sits in. Great. All right. Now, we've got all that clean. We've got that grease. That doesn't get grease. That doesn't get grease, in my opinion. I'm sure other people have different methods. But I'm a great believer in less is more with these as regards to grease and stuff. Okay, it's gonna lie on top. Yeah, you need to get the lever past this hole. Just like that. And we're on. Get your screws. Don't forget this one with the fiber washer. Goes over here. Right now, this guy in here, get your Q-tip, rub it with your finger a little bit, get a good band of acetone on there and rub that in there. That's got a lot of dirt and crap, as you can see. So we're gonna put a little bit of oil in there so everything's tickety-boo, but give that a good clean. And then you remember the ball bearing that fell out earlier? We're gonna drop that back in there. Boom. And then we're gonna get this guy, which is covered in crap. And then we're gonna drop a little bit of, we're gonna drop a little bit of oil on here. As you can see, this stuff, as we showed you before, is baked on kind of stuff. And I'm gonna show you what I do. So this is what I use to clean my baked on parts. It's from Harbor Freight, it's an ultrasonic cleaner. We put water and I think it's Super Plus, the degreaser purple stuff. And drop this in. Put the lid on. We set the time, so let's go 380 and on. And we'll let that guy brew. Okay, so that has now brewed for a little while. Let's take the lid off. This is also heated up, by the way, so. And, ooh, look at that. We have nice clean parts. And it gets into the, you know, the nooks and crannies and what have you. A little bit there left over, but we'll take care of that with some Q-tips. And this guy here, that needs to spin. But yeah, pretty much got it all off. And it's a big time saver. And like I said, it gets into all the grooves and areas. So there we go, we have some nice clean parts. As I was saying earlier, some of this has got some good baked on, but we'll clean that with some acetone and Q-tip right there. As you can see, that comes right off. Make sure these pulls move nicely. They're supposed to be free moving. We don't put grease on those. But I'll show you that in a moment. Also, this guy right here, this sleeve has to rotate. A lot of times that is stuck and you literally have to just bathe it in acetone and gently move it with a pair of needle nose pliers. but give that a really good clean. And yeah, this has actually been a nice one. I've seen much, much worse. But anyway, this transport slide assembly, this all needs to be moved freely. This is an escape lever. A lot of the times this is very stuck, and same thing, it's a rivet. Don't ever take that rivet out. You'll never replace it. You just have to put a bit of soldering iron on there, heat it up, get the gunk out, and make sure it moves freely like this. Sometimes they're really stuck, sometimes they're not. Same with this guy, just make sure it moves freely. Okay, that's the majority of our parts cleaned, and now it's time to put a little bit of grease on everything. Like I said, less is more. So this is where I put grease. Other people slap it on all over the place or do a little differently than me, but that's that there, that's that. Oh yeah, this guy. And then we put some grease on this. As you can see, this bearing area, the reflection where this guy slides along, we do a nice little less is more, in my opinion. But yeah, just like that. And we put a nice bunch around there. And we're gonna put a little bit in here, like that. Also, on this guy, that sleeve, that rotating sleeve, that needs a little bit. And then on the pulls here, I just dab a little bit of oil, just a tiny smidge, like that. Just to make sure that's gotta be really free moving. No grease, just a little bit, tiny smidge of oil, but that's me. And I did all that there, that goes on there. As you can see, spins nicely. Then we get the transport. I call it the transport. It's probably called something else. Ed Morris, remember that name? Go to the link. It's really good. He took a lot of time doing that that tutorial. And I referred to it when I was starting out in this game a lot. Like I said, it is a Cobra-matic. But not much has changed. A bit has changed, but the basic functions are still there. Bit much there, take that off. So now we're down in here, then we go. This is a bearing surface right here. It's gonna go on there. I never grease this thing around here, but I do just there, where those little indentations ride. That's about it. Underneath there, no, not even there. Don't know why, maybe you're supposed to, but I never do. And it seems to work out fine. Same thing here, no grease, but just a smidge of oil, just to keep that thing a little bit wet. No grease, just a smidge of oil, and that's it. Okay, so we got grease on the underside. We're not going to put any grease on here yet till it's actually on here. Now is the time to release the rubber band. So we have this lever is on top. And the trick is to get these two like this in between here. Not below it, not above it, but in that space. And what I normally do is now is I release that lever, so the tone arm, it just makes it easier to get this on, which you'll see in a moment. This doesn't always go to plan brilliantly the first time, but we're gonna get this in here. That scoops on there. Yep. And then we get that guy on the wrong side of there, on the right side. Like I say, it's a bit fiddly, as you can see. Everything's gonna kind of line up. Once you get it on there, make sure there's some free movement. But, and that is in between, which it is. We've got this underneath here, travels along. And like I said, we'll get the tone on back up there now. It's free moving, good. Back at the indentation right there. Springs on the right side. There we go.
Something's...
Oh, there we go, that's why. Get that the right side of that. There we go. All right. Trial and error. It is tricky. Once you've done it a few times, you'll get it. But that's basically this lever here. Has got to get the other side of the pole for this to rotate properly. It's kind of hard to explain from a top view because you should be looking like this. Now we're going to put a little bit of grease along here. Just check that we are still recording. That's where that washer sits, and same on here. If you think about it, this is upside down right now. This is the most of the bearing surface of this transport carriage assembly. And we're going to put a bunch around here, also underneath this spring arm, and over here, like that. Some over here. Around there. Okay, so now back to our screws. If you remember earlier, the one with the washer goes right there. These guys go right here. There we go. And it's moving, still moving freely. It's a good sign. Drop that on there, get the big screw. That does go. This is the speed control arm right here, which moves the idler up and down the motor spindle for the correct speed. This needs a clean because it's a traveling surface. So we're gonna give that a clean. And we're also gonna drop a little bit of grease, just a tiny bit. So that's the bottom side pretty much done. I'm sure I've missed something and somebody will point it out, but as far as I can see, I got everything cleaned and greased that needed to be done for this particular unit, because it's actually not in bad condition at all. And now we have to take this motor bearing off where the armature sits inside. The top one you can get to and you can oil it. This one you have to undo. Now, these can be really hard to get off because of all the heat on, off of the motor itself generates a lot of heating here. So these things can sometimes be welded inside. The nut one's not so bad, but the screw one can sometimes, and you can, sometimes hard to get off, and you can actually strip this. So get a nice big long screwdriver, because with a bit of length, you can get a bit more torque on it. And you're gonna stick it on there, get over and press down and turn. There we go. I think that guy's captive on the other side on this one. Sometimes a nut will fall off. We might get lucky. Some are captive, some aren't. We'll take this one off here. This is usually easier because it's a nut. Boom, good. And I dropped that. I think there's a washer somewhere. No, there's no washer on that. All right, I'm gonna put that up there. And then what I do, so it goes on the way it came off, not that it really matters, but I like to do it, is to get a little line there. Then we're gonna pull that off. And there you can see the bearing bushing with oil, foam, felt, whatever you want to call it. I guess it's not really a bearing, it's just kind of like a bushing. I always call it a bearing. But anyway, we're going to clean that out. Get that in there. Clean it out. Good. We'll clean the top of the armature, motor armature right there. This does not need to come out. Some people say it has to. I've never took one out that didn't need to be because it was seized. And then we got our trusty oil here. This is a 3-in-1, I think 3-in-1 motor oil, specific motor oil, because it's got the right viscosity. Anyway, we're gonna put a nice, get that felt, foam, whatever they use, nice and wet, a little bit in there. Pop on there. And we're gonna put it on the way it came off. Goes on there. Bottom side done. Let's flip it over. Now we're gonna put the retaining clip back on for the main drive spindle cog thing. We're gonna clean around there. I should have done that earlier actually. But we're gonna clean around there. Put a smidge of grease around it, like that. Just a little bit. You've got this, I guess it's called a spring. It's kind of a spring washer. As you can see, it's kind of concave or convex, depending on which way you're looking at it. Anyway, it goes concave up, or is it concave down? Anyway, get that on there. And clip, we're on. We're gonna test this in a moment. And we're gonna test it by hand, never with the motor to begin with. You wanna make sure it moves freely. But let's take these motor mounts off. These are pretty simple. Other versions are harder, especially the Cobra-matics, which have a whole motor carriage here. They're a little trickier. But this is would you call it the modern version? Anyway, the version after the Cobra-matic. They're a lot easier to get off. You're gonna just basically two at a time. Don't do all three because you want it to hang so it's easier to put on, like that. And as you can see, the motor's kind of hanging now. We pop those off. And as you can see, they're all hard and starting to crumble. Well, we're gonna put new ones on. That guy comes off. And we're gonna put these guys. These are brand new ones from Gary Stork at Voice of Music. And we're gonna pop them in. You could clean all that, but doesn't really need it. So that goes in, that goes in. Feel free to fast forward through this. Voila, we have new nice motor mounts, isolate the motor noise from our unit. We're gonna clean this. This is the motor spindle capstan, which the idler wheel sits on. It's grooved for different speeds. That will need a clean. Get your oil, right down here is where you can get to that. felt, foam, part of the bushing bearing. That needs a good drink. Put a nice two or three good squirts in there, get that nice and moist. That's that done. Now, here, this is, as I put the speed up, this is that speed where you see the idler wheel will come up and down on this. I'll show you that when it's on there. But that's the idler wheel spindle. So we need to clean that. We're gonna drop a little bit of oil right on that spindle. And here we have our new original proper bronze, brass, whatever it is, idler wheel. As you can see, compared to that piece of, this really is rubbish. I don't know why they were making them. Anyway, I don't know if you can see, but it was cracked down there anyway. But anyway, we've got the original back on. You get these from Gary Stoke at Voice of Music. Yours will be hard, probably. You have to send it in to get it retreaded. It's a great service and it works great. So with a bit of oil, we just, oh, hang on. There's a little spacer washer here. We're gonna put that on. We're gonna drop that guy over there. And then this little clip. Sometimes there's another fiber washer underneath this because of, depending on the depth of the idler wheel, but this one doesn't have one. Clip. Okay, now that's off, good. This screw right there adjusts the height of the idler wheel. As you can see, if I can get it lined up nicely, that right there is the 33 spot. Let me get a screwdriver. That's the 33 RPM spot for the correct speed for that wheel to drive onto. That's 45, that's 16, that's 78. You wanna make sure that that tread is in the center of that and you adjust that accordingly, up or down to make it ride in the right spot. Now with that all done, motor mounts, now we're gonna clean down in here. This is where the platter bearing rests. There's a bunch of old grease and gunk in there. Clean upside the shaft as well. You're gonna get your bearing, which is full of hard, not good grease, and you clean it all out. I get a little jeweler's screwdriver, pop it out. You could put this in the ultrasonic as well, but get all the old grease, clean it out with acetone, both sides. Then you're gonna fill it. You're gonna fill it with the lithium and pop it on, same with the washer. So you clean that out, you clean round in there, and you got it full of grease. We're gonna drop it on, like so. We're gonna put a little bit of grease around this bearing circle of the spindle shaft. This is where the platter goes on, obviously. And then there's another washer, which you drop over the like that. And then the platter will rest on there. And while we're at it, here's a shameless plug. If you have lost your bearing, which sometimes it happens, I lose my bearings all the time. But if you've lost your bearing or it's just absolute crap, here is a replacement that I sell on my eBay store. It is 9 balls in the cage instead of, what is that, 5? And also comes with a nice race washer. So if you need one, contact me or search it on eBay. But it's a great upgrade and or replacement. Okay, so we've done that. Now we have the platter. Pretty damn simple. You're gonna clean in here, clean down the center, and then you've already got grease on there, but clean around there, put a little bit of grease on this area right here, where the drive gear is. Put a bit of grease around there. Also, this is where the idler wheel sits and drives. This gets all kind of cruddy, and this is what causes slip. And slip means loss of speed. Get yourself a rag, a little bit of acetone on your rag, and give it a good wipe in there like this. And that will get all the residue rubber off, especially if the wheel is hard and been used. It'll just kind of make it a very sheeny shiny, and it will slip. With the acetone, it gives it, cleans it, and you get a bit more grip. Okay, time for cleaning. Okay, so we did a bit of cleaning already. You can use Super Clean or Simple Green, depending on how caked on it is. You can't really, this is kind of like baked on enamel. You can't really hurt it. But what happens a lot with the Motorola is this gold is all tarnished. And would you believe it, a lot of this stuff is actually nicotine. I have had many consoles with a nice layer of nicotine smoke on them. This stuff's kind of hard to get off. What I do use though is Brasso. This is I guess it was a British stuff eventually, or originally, sorry. And it's good because it's really a wadding, and it's not too corrosive at all, but it gets off the crap, as you can see. I know, we're having an infomercial now. So, nice and shiny. You probably have to rub it down with some rags every now and then because your fingerprints get on it. But we'll put the platter on. I don't know if there's any other better trick than this to get this thing on, but basically you lift up the anti-wreck, the other stops the other record from dropping. Paul. Okay, so I'm gonna power this up and we're gonna see if it works. Okay, she's nice and clean and shiny and ready for some bench testing. Got her all hooked up with the wires and the power. Couple of things first I forgot to tell you about. So this shaft here needs to be cleaned and a little bit of oil applied. A little bit of oil applied here. This is for the 12-inch sensor. And also, what I do is blast a little bit of WD-40 down in here, just a tiny smidge, because that's the tone arm swivel bearing. That needs to be lubed. We didn't talk about the cartridge. The cartridge on this is a Sonotone 16T. I don't know if it works. We haven't tested it yet, but it looks in really good condition. The Sonotone 16T is a great cartridge. I hope it does work. I did put a new needle on it. That's a new needle. So let's plop a record on. We got some Dino here, because I know I won't get a lot of shit from YouTube for playing it. Pardon my French. I'm doing this one-handed as well. I don't advise you to do that. Anyway, we got a record on. It's free moving there. Good. Let's. Okay, isn't that just glorious? Works very nicely. Obviously, we're going to put it back in the console and test it with its original amplifier. But this has been quite a success. This was a very light service. They are worse and you might have to take more apart to clean. But this was pretty damn good as regards to dirt and grease. Anyway, I hope yours is the same, and more to come. Well, there she is, all put back together,
cleaned up and ready for the party. Talking about cleaning, we started with this Method wood cleaner, which is nice and mild and very, very natural. And then we gave her a good coating with this, just to get that wood to pop and get all the scratches and little dings, which is very, 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 very mild on this unit. And talking about that, I'd like to thank Randy Kay for allowing me to use his console, which I was restoring to be part of this video, to be the video. This is his unit. He has a great eye and has an awesome appreciation for stereo consoles, so I want to thank him very much. But I think I'll leave you with Barry White, who I actually bumped into once, but that's another story. I'll leave you with Barry because it's good to show off this center channel. The bass response is amazing, and I think Barry's the guy to do it. All right, hope you enjoyed the show, and we'll do another one.